Depending on where you live, every now and then there is an incredible view of the night sky, where you can see hundreds of thousands of tiny points of light. We know that some of these lights are planets, some are stars, and some are even galaxies. But where did all these cosmic objects come from? Ideas about origin of things have always made fascinating science. Most astronomers use the Big Bang theory to explain how the universe began, but some people oppose the Big Bang, have been generally uninformed about its fundamental tenets.
The tenets of the Big Bang, that the universe started out small, hot, dense, where matter and energy were a primordial soup, where the forces of nature had merged, is thoroughly supported by observations of this universe. Now, there are some things that, well, did this really cause that, or might it be something that we don't know about yet? And who ordered up the dark matter? We don't know where that came from. And where's this expansion? We don't know where that came from, but we can describe it and we can measure it.
Big Bang cosmology is based on the strength of many arguments. Yet there are still some unresolved issues. Wide range of empirical evidence supports the notion that the universe has been expanding and cooling for the last 13.8 billion years. Logically, we'd expect space to be 13.8 billion light-years across, but the size of the observable universe is actually 46 billion light-years, meaning that the very first light we can see emitted, 380,000 years after the Big Bang, came from a distance that is now 46 billion light-years away. The size of the whole universe is unknown, and it might be infinite in extent. Some parts of the universe are too far away for the light emitted since the Big Bang to have had enough time to reach Earth or space-based instruments, and therefore lie outside the observable universe.
We look out to the edge of the observable universe, and we see light that has been traveling for 13.8 billion years. That gives us evidence of the Big Bang for that part of the universe experiencing it at the time it emitted that light. That horizon continues to push out. As long as we keep seeing evidence of the Big Bang, we are still moving into a universe that's our whole. Imagine the day where that horizon washes over the last bit of matter that experienced the Big Bang. Then the information coming to us about the Big Bang ceases. And all of what we know of cosmology would have no data set at that point. Yeah. And at that point, you're basically the moving horizon, which gets one light year away from us per year at that speed, would have overtaken the last matter of the universe, and that would be the edge of the universe.
The cosmic inflation suggests that before time began, all the energy in the cosmos was contained in a singularity, an infinite dimensionless point not described by the laws of physics. There is a point in time beyond which we have no observable reach, so anything beyond that becomes increasingly speculative. This speculation is based on data, assuming equations remain valid under conditions far beyond where they have been tested. The instant immediately following the initial singularity is part of the Planck epoch, the earliest period of time in the history of our universe.
The Big Bang was a name given to this idea that the universe started in this one primordial explosion. It was given pejoratively to this idea by proponents of what at the time was known as the steady state hypothesis, one where the universe always was and always will be. Even though it's expanding, it's always been expanding. And matter is spontaneously created in the vacuum to fill in for where space is getting thinner, so that you'd always see a universe that looked about the same. This is called the steady state hypothesis. You could get that out of Einstein's equations of gravity. That was allowed. But another solution was one where we're either collapsing or where we're expanding. All three solutions were allowed. It was an equal competitor to the steady state theory for decades until we finally got some evidence to support the Big Bang. And that was the famous cosmic microwave background. This is a leftover signature from an explosion that started in one hot primeval fireball. In the old days, we'd come up with an understanding of the universe. A new law has been discovered. That's a very exciting time in science when that happens. And then you learn later on that with better instruments and more tools and deeper thinkers, that what you came up with as a law was a smaller subset of a larger understanding. So you shouldn't call it a law, but it works. So we just use the word theory for everything that works now. So it's not like science goes from one truth to another truth, discarding previous truth, not the physical sciences at least.
According to Tyson, progress has already been made to resolve some of the problems with the Big Bang. The most significant modification is known as inflationary cosmology, where the energetics of the early universe passes through a phase that spontaneously triggers a period of extremely rapid expansion. Big Bang models have revealed new mysteries of their own, for example, the horizon problem, the magnetic monopole problem, and the flatness problem are most commonly resolved with inflationary theory. But the details of the inflationary universe are still left unresolved, and many, including some founders of the theory, say it has been disproven. Judging inflation on how well it fits with anybody's speculative ideas about Planck-scale physics, physics that is well beyond what is observationally tested, is inappropriate, are still left unresolved. According to Tyson, scientific evidence in support of a theory sometimes takes you places where your senses have never been. Tyson explains how science develops over time and how scientists are usually wrong, as science, in the end, still ends up correct.
So there's a lot of misunderstanding about science as an enterprise. If you perform an experiment that demonstrates the conduct of reality, maybe I don't agree with that experiment because maybe I think you're biased. Then you're trying to get that result and you're either intentionally biased or you're passively biased, but I'm gonna doubt you. I'm gonna perform that same experiment and see if I get the same result. If I get the same result and I'm a completely different person, then maybe that result is reality. Now, but still two is not enough because I use an experiment of the same design. Someone, a third person comes in and say, I'm not gonna use that design because I think that design of your experiment is flawed. Because this is an important result. I'm not gonna base the whole thing on just what you got, all right? So now you create a whole new kind of apparatus and you have the same result. Then you have experimental consensus and a new truth emerges about the operations of nature. That truth does not later on get overturned. That's not how it works. What gets overturned are ideas that are not yet experimentally verified. And any research journal is full of ideas that in 6 months or a year will get tossed, modified, reworked, ignored. So people say, oh, science is just one day you want to believe this and then you believe that. And I say, what's your best example? They talk about the flat Earth versus the round Earth. That was back 500 years ago. Science, as I now describe it to you, has taken on this identity basically since Galileo, 1600 onwards. In that era, experimentally determined truths do not get undone. What happens is, take Newton's laws, for example, he has a law of motion and law of gravity. Then we find out, wait a minute, if there's a high gravity source, Newton's laws fail. If you're moving really fast, faster than a running horse, whatever Newton might have experienced in his life, his equations begin to break down. Do you throw away all of Newton? No, it works in all the other cases. So what's going on? Einstein comes up with laws of motion, his special theory of relativity. Einstein comes up with a new law of gravity, his general theory of relativity. Do they replace Newton? No, they draw a bigger circle around the applicability of Newton's laws. Newton's laws apply here. Einstein's laws take over for the rest of the universe. And if you put in low speeds and low gravity in Einstein's equations, they become Newton's equation. Given that fact, all I will tell you is a strongly held idea that was not experimentally verified, but everyone was really sure it had to have been true, then it got overthrown, and that was the luminiferous ether. The idea that sound requires air or a table or some medium through which to propagate. Light, which is also a wave, surely must require a medium as well. But there's the vacuum of space, and clearly we get light from the sun and the rest of the stars. So what medium is carrying the light? So everybody invented a medium, the ether, calculated what light must be doing through it. And in the late 1800s, early 1900s, experiments were done to show not only do we not need the ether, light travels just fine through a vacuum, and it propagates in a different way from sound. So our understanding grew, ether got thrown out the window overnight, and we moved on.
Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.